Game number two in this best of five. Winner gets that prize possession, the golden ticket to Worlds Lion, up one game already. Siva gets banned away, and once again, Albus Nox, they don't want to deal with that at all. Shen will be the following ban here for Lion.
So the Siva being taken away once again. There's the Cassio 2. We expected this one to come out. Now, the question is, are they going to stick to the Braum ban, or are they going to change something up? They could consider taking the Tahm Kench off the board, given its effectiveness in game one, or they could just stick to their guns.
Have to see what works for them. Be interesting to see. No adaptation, but the Kench actually getting put on the bench here, and Arce might have a little bit of a cheeky grin after that one, because he did such a good job saving his teammates from the brink of death multiple times.
Question now is if Lion is going to levy a brand ban. Now that the Tahm Kench is there, cannot save anyone else, now they can't find themselves in a position where they can save him.
It's got to be Gnar or Gangplank, I feel.
Malzahar, actually.
Either. Interesting.
Ooh, this is going to be a very loaded pick and ban phase here.
So targeted towards Kira right there. He's obviously played it a lot. We didn't see the Malz ban come out. Bear in mind the things that have now been left available. The Bard is up and the Braum is up. So I would not be surprised to see Lion look to get themselves an early Braum, given as to how proficient they are. And with Tahm Kench taken off the table, the next best pick into that would be someone like the Bard or the Taric that Albus could bring themselves out. So in terms of first rotation, Gnar makes the most sense, or something like the Rek'Sai to get that early jungle pressure going.
One big question now is, where does the Varus fit? It was a nice last pick on purple side. Might not see it as a blind blue side pick, but we saw it yesterday.
Really?
And the Jhin pick is a major priority for Albus Nox here.
So now you just go Gnar, Gragas, if you're Lion Gaming. I mean, there's no reason not to. They've already picked their AD carry. You get a strong jungler in the form of Gragas who acts as engage, disengage, and also really good scaling. Yes, you lose a bit on early pressure, but that doesn't matter because if you have a Gnar, he has no bad matchups. You could go for the Echo, maybe the Fiora, but other than that, like you're just setting yourself up because they can get the counter pick in bot. They know that the Jhin is coming out. Lion could look to pick up the Ashe later on. Just, I feel like this Jhin first pick was a mistake. I don't agree with it at all.
Well, that's the thing, right? We've said this about Albus Nox. They find their engage in the strangest of places here, and once again, it seems that they are proficient on that Jhin. The curtain call was quite good, and now that the Kench is off the table, they might actually be able to zero in on the correct targets without him getting them to safety, but they go with the Braum as their support pick here.
Here's the thing, it may seem like a mistake, but Albus Nox once again find comfort in the Jhin. If they get the Jhin, it opens up the brand. If they get the brand, it opens up really the composition that they've been going for. Now, they don't have the Malzahar, so question is how they're going to have the extra engage in their comp. So it's going to be interesting to see. Hovering over the rise, I'm not
so
sure.
The answer for Albus Nox now is to go for... You want to try and save your mid and support for the final picks, so you then try and look to pick up your jungler now. Wouldn't be surprised if it was the Gragas and... Oh, now I'm cheating because I see that they've logged it in. So it is in fact the Gragas and the Gangplank. But this is risky again because you have a losing lane in the top. Because Lion know what the bottom lane is, wouldn't be surprised to see them go for the Lucian here. Yeah. Something that you talked about earlier on. Very lane dominant when you pair it up with the Braum. It's also White Lotus is one of his comfort picks. And if we thought that he could outplay his opponents on an Ashe, then imagine what he could do on the Lucian. And then you could also just round it out with your jungler here to save your mid to guarantee say at the counter pick. And come on now, Lion, don't troll us. Don't do it again.
That's the five, buddy.
They've got that one game buffer, so who knows, they could pull out something cheeky. We've seen him on the Kog'Maw before, and like you said, it did quite well in the lane. Don't think they'll be going with that one though. Hovering the Lucian. Now actually looking in the Zac though.
Ooh, this is a call out. This is actually a really good call out because they know that they set up the lanes that Brand is going to be perfect into Braum. Brand is going to be great into Lucian because Lucian is a mid-range AD carry. So then if they are baiting them into this, you pick the Zac and you really start to challenge the Brand pick. It's something that now Lycrit is not comfortable going towards.
Taro could make much more sense here for Albus Nox because you can see Lion developing a very powerful teamfight composition. You have a very effective engage with the Zac with the follow-up from the Gnar, and then the mid-game power of Lucian is just phenomenal. And Taric is a really good counter teamfighter thanks to his ultimate. And in terms of the laning phase, it's also a very decent pick into the Braum as well. You know, melee matchup into melee matchup. We've seen it come out from Lycrit in the past. It would make a lot of sense. And in terms of mid lane, you could just go for something like the Talia, because it's very safe, it has good pushing power. The only risk then is that you have Sayer's Echo mid, which he brought out on day one, which we found is a very effective pick into it.
Oh, we get to see Kira's Anivia. We're in a treat to behold. This guy used to be known as quite the Anivia main, and then went for a little bit of a more meta champion pool with the Talia, with the Vlad, and with the Malzahar. But take the Malzahar off the table, back to his comfort picks, and Bard, another huge comfort pick for Lucrece.
Okay, so this was a really good pick from Albus Nox, simply because Lion were taking the risk in terms of calling out and challenging the picks from Albus Nox. But now you have an Anivia and a Bard, and it's going to be a really hard time for Zac to have a follow-up on his engage. If he jumps right in, sure, if Gnar jumps right in, Bard, the wall coming from Anivia and the Bard ulti coming in as well means it's going to give Albus Nox a lot of time to move in these team fights, a lot of time to move in these skirmishes. And of course, we've seen a lot of play coming out of Akira's Anivia in the history of his play overall.
Thing is, I'm afraid I'm going to have to disagree with you, because I feel like Anivia into this comp is extremely ballsy. She is super low mobile, 1 to 5 she is incredibly weak, she has no pushing power. To set up for her damage, she relies on the enemy team positioning in a way where she can get that free damage down. But when you look at the mobility, her wall is going to be little to no effective against that composition. You have 5 jumps. You have an incredibly powerful hard engage comp. She is super low mobility. And then you have a Zac, a Gnar, and a Lissandra to just dive onto that backline and make her life hell.
That's true.
I feel like that this Anivia is really going to struggle. And I also think that Oddi should prioritize all of his attention ganking mid. It is so easy to gank a Lissandra lane, especially at the level 6 mark. And when you also have 3 points into your E, you can do it from behind the wall. You can do it from blind vision. There's nothing that the Anivia can do about it. And I mean, I honestly feel like Lion have come out ahead in the draft in this
one. And this is going to be a very interesting game to behold. We've got the Zac, we've got the Anivia facing off against the Rift. It feels like years ago this would be common practice. But Kira, very confident on the Anivia. Lucrit, very confident on the Bard. It feels like comfort is the name of the game here. They're back at home. They're back in the nice comfy chairs, playing in a familiar surrounding, playing the League of Legends that they love to play. So we'll have to see if it works out for them here.
It's going to have to depend on the positioning, because while I do agree with you that the composition, they have so much, Lion have a lot of abilities to be able to get into the back line. They can't do it front to back. They have to be able to get position on Lissandra, Gnar, Zac, to be able to come from a flanking position or just to catch him off guard with proper vision control. If they go front to back, then it gives the composition of Albus Nox enough time, especially with Gragas, to really look to disengage from the back line.
Okay, and you can hear the crowd. They're ready. They're pumped as they do get drowned out here. But nonetheless, we got an epic game coming up. And the Lissandra is going to be such an impossible threat to deal with, especially Anivia. Those Qs are going to have to be on point. But have to see how the matchup in the top goes as well. They're picking that gangplank for Smurf up again. But we are jumping into game number 2. Lion versus Anox. Lion up 1 already for their ticket to the World Championship.
Now, we need to talk about the Zac. Quite a creative pick, something that we don't see very often. We did see it come out in the C9 versus TSM series. Mm-hmm. I believe it was game 3, game 2 or 3, one or the other. But Meteos was the guy that brought it out. He used to be very well known for that Zac. And now we're seeing it once again from Oddi. Now, from what I can recall, there were made no changes to Zac in the recent patches. And yeah. This is very much a comfort thing that they have identified as being strong. His ability to trade in the early game is incredibly weak, because remember that he has to sacrifice his own health to actually use his abilities. He can pick up those blobs to get a percentage of his health back, but in terms of actual early game trading, he's not that strong, which is why he's actually a very good pick into the Gragas.
Well, that's the interesting thing about Zac's Bloblets, is the moves cost a percentage of your current health, where the Bloblets heal for a percentage of your maximum health. So essentially, the lower you get, the more you'll be healing.
Yeah. In terms of jungle clear in the early game, it's a little bit rough, but that's why he's so good against champions like Gragas, who primarily are focused on farming their own jungle. They're not really interested in invading. They're not interested in trying to set up any sort of early plays, and that just allows the Zac to have free farming during the early game. He can just get through what is usually known as the rough part, And then he can just scale up to the level 5, level 6 mark where he'll have a couple points in his leap, and he can then look to set up plays around the mid lane or around the top.
Yeah, so this was a great setup and pick and ban for Lion to be able to allow Audi the time to really just farm up. So every lane right now is working well for them. Anivia is going to get shoved in. Top lane is going to get shoved in. Smurf is going to have a difficult time once again in this matchup. And then the bottom lane as well. They have great skirmish, but we might see something here.
Yep. Sayer just going to claw himself to safety. But you saw the votes before. Looks like Albus Nox have found themselves some fans. 11% opposed to 9 this time around. So it's starting to heat up here, Vedius.
Yeah, it does seem that Albus Nox, the fans are now... Okay, back from
there.
Work, waking up. Australia's in a weird part of the world. I can never tell what time it is everywhere else. But the mid lane matchup is actually quite an interesting one because you have two ice mages effectively throwing rocks of ice at one another. Lissandra doesn't necessarily have as much pushing power as you would initially think because the Q from... the Anivia can be very effective. Remember that Lissandra is fairly short range, and she gets locked very briefly in an animation when she casts that Q. So if you can predict where she's going to try and set up that shove, you can then land your Q aggressively, which will not only help shove the wave out a little bit, but you can then land the stun, and then you can look to trade back on her. So Lissandra will have a slight edge, but it's not so overwhelming that the Anivia can't deal with it.
Smurf. First a flash, Audi just... showcasing just how good Zac is at ganking from Fog of War.
Meanwhile, this bottom lane matchup is something that I actually wanted to see and was looking forward to in this tournament because both of these AD carries do favor it. So you might see a gank here.
Oh, Flash Body Slam comes on in. Arsa is going to get hit up with the snare. Likrit flashing in, finds a stun against the wall. Do they have enough damage? Miracle flashes in, gets first blood.
That's exactly what they needed. Got that gank going forward because this matchup was getting fairly difficult for a Miracle.
And honestly, good use of the Magical Journey coming out from Bard to allow the Gragas to come in from the flank. He didn't have to use his Flash E that early on, and he actually caught Wild Lotus off guard to then set up for the follow-up from Bard. And honestly, good timing as well from Likrit to wait on actually using the Cosmic Binding to get the root down onto White Lotus to enable them to then get the kill. They had to use a lot of flashes, so Audi could look to rotate bot and try and respond, but he's more interested in setting up an advantage in the top.
Once again, PvP Stayhost is staying in the bottom lane, but this gank.
Elastic Slingshot does land. Smurf eats an orange to try and keep himself sustained, but it's not going to matter. Geraldo flashes, gets the one for one. Smurf, good play.
Good, the best of a bad situation for Smurf. He didn't have his flash available, and in all honesty, I feel like Audi should have just taken the extra tower shot. He should have popped into his passive. He wouldn't have lost his life, and just that would have enabled enough time for Geralt to get himself that kill and not lose his life on the back end. So, honestly, that wasn't as bad as it could have been for Smurf.
Exactly. So one big point going straight back to this bottom lane is Likrit right now is actually going to make Sia. Have to respect that pressure. But overall, this bottom lane is going to be difficult simply because Braum and Lucian is hell for the Jhin pick. Now, Jhin can actually repel a lot of that early pressure since Lucian does have to scale up and get the armor 10 going for him. But once he does actually look to get it, the all-in is going to be A, it's going to be difficult, but B, Lucian can trade through the wave with his Q and get as much damage done as possible for Miracle.
Look, they know that this could be a potential... weakness for Anox having this Anivia, so they're paying a lot of attention to ensure that he can lane quite safely. We saw Likrit doing the roam. Claw comes in, actually gets the snare. Don't think it's enough damage to kill him. Might just egg him here though. No cleanse being burned and just pops a passive. Stayhos and Sejos actually having a little bit of a battle here. Audi and Stayhos rather.
So that was actually good from Sayer. He was applying a lot of pressure down onto Kira. What Kira was doing though was he was burning all of his mana to trade back with Sayer. He felt like that Sayer was... he was starting to read his movements. He was doing a good job of landing those Qs, and that was forcing Sayer to use his mana to trade back as well. But the difference is he had his teleport. So when he was forced back, he returned to lane. Kira had a significant disadvantage in terms of mana, so it then became so much easier for Sayer to walk up aggressively and start trading. And once Kira took too much poke, it ended up like it could in the bot.
Oh, Elastic Slingshot comes in, but Magical Journey could get them to safety. Gets the stun onto White Lotus. There's the Gangplank ulti. Here comes Gragas. White Lotus, he might be in trouble. He gets blown up. Smurf actually picks off that one. Deadly Flourish finds it onto Audi, who's forced to flash. Slingshots himself to safety, but The gank gets turned around.
That was a good idea from Lion, but of course you follow the brand, or at least the Bard magical
journey. I know, how confusing is that?
It's back and forth with this guy.
Yeah, it's the worst.
You cannot afford to take an adventure where you just don't know the destination, unfortunately. White Lotus, he did not have his flash, and here we go, a contention over the blue.
Oddie does smite that one away, but it does deny it from Saya, so we'll be struggling with a little bit of mana. Kira finds the stun, finds a flash frost, and now you may have found Saya. Might have to burn the flash here. Lucrit can't find the stun, though.
Good use of the root to buy himself a little bit of extra time. But that was also smart from Kira, as he's now caught up.
Well, Kira with no passive available, forced to turn around, does get the passive onto Zac in return. Seos has to respect that one. Does the barrel have enough damage? Very, very close, as Oddie life flashes before his eyes.
If Seiya had enough mana for his ultimate, if the ultimate had come off cooldown, that could have certainly gone a different way. But so far, the early game going heavily in the favor of Albus Nox. Good advantages being gained in the bottom lane. And honestly, like, a good response to the Gangplank ultimate. It came the moment that the three members of Lion had gone through that magical journey. And thankfully, because of the knockback from Stajos, it actually knocked the White Lotus into the ultimate again, giving Smurf the kill. So all that pressure that was accrued in the top half of the map has now been slightly mitigated by that extra kill that Smurf was able to get himself.
Yeah, exactly. And while Oddie was saved from Arceus, something we didn't really notice was he put up his Braum shield while PvP Stajos did have his ult cask available, and he was looking to get it off, but couldn't. Was not able to.
Look, just burning flashes on cooldown here. Smurf has to respect that.
Now we see things slowing down a little bit, but as we were talking about doing champion select, the top lane once again going in favor of the Nard. This time, though, much more heavily in the favor of Jarrah. You can see a big CS differential already starting to accrue. Zac has gotten through what was the rough part of the game, which is his 1-5 early clear. He's now at a point where he can very easily clear his jungle, as we see a bit of trading in the bottom lane.
White Lotus doesn't get the favorable exchange out of that. Miracle has the ult available, finds the first shot onto Arce. Second one connects as well. Can Licorice find a Sun? There's a Gangplank ulti on the back. Now Arce, the heal comes out of White Lotus. Captive Audience slows him a little bit. Licorice, ooh, narrowly avoids the Captive Audience, but there is the Tempered Fate. Can they get in range for it? The stun doesn't land as the beautiful Braum blocks it away. Here comes Oddie. Elastic Slingshot still too low rank to find anything.
Yeah, Oddie just tried to play defense there to see if Albus Nox tried to play a little too far forward. But that was just great for Albus Nox to really disengage the early pressure coming in from White Lotus and the RC.
Honestly, as well, just White Lotus not really respecting the damage coming out from Miracle. I thought that Arce was actually holding onto his shield until the fourth shot, because there's no point really blocking the earlier ones when that big crit is the thing that you really need to be careful of. But he actually didn't even have it up. He'd already used it in an earlier exchange, which is a large part as to why Miracle decided to go for that lore. And they very nearly came to getting themselves a kill, but the heal from White Lotus was enough to keep their bottom lane alive. And right now they are certainly struggling underneath this pressure.
Yeah, exactly. So one big point was, especially from game one, we wanted to see Albus Nox actually challenge White Lotus's aggression. That is one point that we did see him from, because he dashed in and it looks like they're going to go on Kira.
Oh, a great wall keeps him safe for now. Let's bounce. Use doesn't really get much out of that. Jarrah does layer the CC quite well. Smurf taking a lot of damage, but here comes a crit. Here comes Stajos, and Jarrah, he might have to go for the trade here. Not going to find Exhaust coming out of the support. What are you doing, Smurf?
Great turnaround from Jarrah. It looked like that he was gonna end up going down to a gank, but he returns the favor to Smurf. What was a very difficult situation for him to get out of, he's able to turn around. I was saying that Jarrah was not performing in game one, but I feel like he's definitely stepping it up here in game two.
Look, Smurf, he shouldn't have just gone back in for that Q. That was the greediest Q I've ever seen in my whole life. And he's playing Gangplank. He's a king of greedy cues.
He's got to get the gap. It's all about that bank, man. It's all about that bank.
I guess, right? Look, back in the mid lane, he's doing a good job of surviving. We mentioned in the pick and ban that Lion want to focus a lot of attention on this, but Oddie can't seem to really leave his mark anywhere but that top lane.
Yeah, overall, it was great from Licrit to actually start roaming towards that top side. He did that light in the last game, though it was as a result of a swap in general. But Licrit is kill participation is massive, but that just comes, it just comes off the fact that he does leave Air Miracle to his own device.
You can see the early mobility boots, because this is a trait that Liquid likes to go for, because he likes to roam around the map. But on Bard, there's plenty of opportunities for you to set up plays around the map because of the Tempered Fate, because of the Magical Journey. It just makes it so much easier for him and Stagios to just set up ganks around these different lanes. So, promising from Liquid, but the problem is you can't quite push your early advantage that you're able to get yourself in the bottom lane. And this isn't actually that bad for Albus Nox, simply because Lucian will fall off relative to the Jhin, especially in the late game stages. And in terms of their actual impact, this is often why some people will move away from the Lucian, because he is very much about playing for lane, and if you fall behind in lane, his impact in the game becomes heavily reduced.
He falls off based off of overall play. If A Miracle right now, if he does get the lane down, if the tower does go down for him, if they swap from the matchup entirely, or if it just gets far enough into the game, he needs to swap towards mid side. Otherwise, Lucian will be able to just duel him at every point in the game.
Classic slingshot being charged. Oddie decides against it though. Once again, trying to look for some advantages in the bot lane, but only thing that's working for him so far is burning Smurf's flash. Stagios just going to try and spot out some wards here. Kira doing a good job of staying alive in this lane. And 13 minutes in the game. Gold lead only a couple hundred over to Anox despite having a 2-kill advantage.
Now, for Lion, things are going well in the top half of the map, not so well in the bottom half. You see another gank in the mid.
Well, once again, Kira just sidesteps, but he might be in trouble now. Forces to use a cleanse, but here comes Stagios. He's found onto Saya. The flash comes out from both the mid laners here. Actually, Kira saved his, only using that one. Tempered Fate comes through, can't seem to nick the Lissandra. Stagios goes on in, there's the stun, not gonna land as the claw gets him to safety just in time. Now Oddie looking to turn it around with the elastic slingshot. The crit flashes over, there's the magical journey. Jarl's made his way down. Kira still has the egg available, so only looking to pop the passive, layering down the CC quite well. Here comes the Zach, can he do anything about it? He's so low! Oh, a big slap from the Rift Herald, who's now joined the thick of the fight, and he wants to kill Zach. He wants it, he gets it. Smurf finds a kill in the end, but that was a 6v5.
Unfortunately for Lion, they try to force a play. They could have gone out of that situation, but they decide to commit to the fight. The teleport coming in from Jarl at a not-so-optimal situation results in Albus Nox being able to get themselves a kill. And what's worse for Lion is the fact that Gangplank picks himself up another one, which is honestly exactly where Albus want to be. They want to get this Gangplank ahead. They want to start the snowball in his favor. And I mean, just that whole play was simply a matter of another roam coming out from Liquid. He moved up to the mid lane. He landed the Tempered Fate onto Seo, forcing him into a situation where he, if it wasn't for some very quick thinking and quick response time, he could have very easily lost his life. They may very well do just now.
Oh, Kira just walks straight up, gets the 1v1. This guy is an Anivia monster, I was telling you.
Vettius, you mentioned it early on. The main focus is going to be towards Kira. In fact, a lot of ganks did go towards this mid lane. But right now, Albus Nox are doing a great job at keeping him up and actually continuing plays with the crit roaming.
See, like this jump back in from Oddie is the bit where they should have just disengaged. The teleport coming from Gnar, they feel like they can keep chasing it, but the kiting power of this three-man unit is so strong that it's so difficult for them to actually hard engage. And that was a really good barrel from Stagios to actually knock the Zac away. And then unfortunately for Lion, the Rift Herald just give a bit of extra help over to Anox, getting the kill down onto Oddie.
He smacked him down.
Yeah, it turned into a 6v5.
Yeah.
Yep.
Once again, trying to make a play onto Kira. This time it should be quite easy. He gets locked up, laid on CC. He's just going to be with a side of bacon right now. But Seo's actually coming on in, trying to save him. Can't seem to find it.
No
now
flash.
He might be in trouble. No body slam available just yet. Can't seem to land the elastic slingshot. This time does have the damage reduction from W. Goes for it. Actually jukes him back over the wall. But that's the wrong side of the map, mate.
But right now, oh, he is actually running away. There's no mana on top of Saya. His passive isn't just up yet. It has just come off cooldown. But if he wants to try and close the gap, he's not going to have enough damage.
Lucian's going to cut him off at the very least. He's found himself in an impossible position.
Give the red buff over to the AD carry. Yep. There you go.
White Lotus takes that one, but Arcee, a lot of damage in the meantime. And Liquid wasn't in lane to help that one out, so Miracle forced to watch.
But 3 kills just went over to Lion.
Yeah.
What just happened in the mid lane is what I was expecting to happen for Lion early on. It did not. Oddie didn't put that much pressure. He was focusing on the top half of the map, which has resulted in a big CS advantage for Jural, but hasn't really resulted in any massive net gain. And now we're going to see this all-in power of the Lion bottom lane. So Miracle has the level advantage, but Liquid just takes so much damage. He actually uses the Tempered Fate on himself to buy time. And unfortunately for them, it was just a very early exhaust during the Tempered Fate where they couldn't take the most out of it. White Lotus, good sidestepping to avoid that execute coming out from Albus Nox, but overall, just big mistakes from Albus.
One big point to even talk about, the unexpected consequence of that entire point was A Miracle actually had a sizable HP advantage off of that, even though Bard ended up dying through it. But since White Lotus was able to get the red buff from the kill on Gragas, he was able to regen up to full HP, and now it's even worse. Not only does he have the red buff proc, but he has full HP. Jin had no advantage in that entire scenario.
Lion looking to pressure down this bot lane tower. Arce just clearing out pink wards, and once again, Oddie, he's hanging around. Captive audience does spot him out, but at this stage, they just want to brute force it seems.
Look at the rotation from the Anivia, moving to the bottom half of the map to try and provide some additional support. Remember, the Gangplank ult can also act as wave clear.
Oh, Steos can't seem to find the body slam. Arce sidesteps that one. Should have his W to get himself to safety, should need be.
Oh, those juicy Anivia roams.
She's so slow.
Yeah.
She has level 2 boots and it doesn't even look like she's moving fast.
What I don't understand from Lion is they have so much control in the bot lane. There's no real need to control, to look to take down this bot tower. They can actually just use their shove to then walk top. There's nothing holding them.
The thing is, they can. It's fine for them to maintain pressure in the bot because of the amount of pressure that Jural has in the top side of the map. And sending Oddie there is also drawing Kira away from the mid lane, which is enabling Sayer to get the additional push on. Because when you match up against an Anivia, the amount of wave clear that Anivia has is just really unparalleled. So it's trying to draw the Anivia away from mid, but it's also just helping slowly wither down that tower that is just ever so low. And then it's also keeping Gragas away from being able to do anything else on the map. So he can't help top lane, he can't help mid, and instead he's just forced to just do what he can in the bottom half of the map.
Well, he's still down here. He's really persistent and can't seem to find anything else, so where else is he going to be? They do have their advantages elsewhere, but White Lotus did pick up 2 kills, started 0-2. Rift Herald returns to the Void. He did pick himself up 1 kill already, so he's happy with that one. His bloodlust has been sated for now.
1-0-0.
Look, we saw how easy it was once Oddie lands a CC to take out Kira. Just why can't they keep just replicating that?
Well, I mean, that's the big question, really.
Yeah.
I suppose Kira does have his cleanse up, which will make it a little bit difficult, but when you just consider cooldowns, it should be very easy to burn his flash. Honestly, if I was in Lion's position, if I was Sayer, I'd be like, just camp mid.
Yeah.
Top lane should win. Bot lane should win. Yes, ooh, she has egg.
TP coming in.
TP in on the back. Miracle actually gets stunned up by his own Lucrit. He might be in trouble now. Gangplank ulti gives him a little bit of safety, but Jural looking for something. The first one from mid is going to be Kira. Sayer found his way in, teleported there. So they do trade 0-1 for now. Lucrit was the first one to go down, but Arce can't seem to close the gap.
That was actually best case scenario for Albus Nox. They only lost 1 kill to a double TP play. Of course, Oddie might just go in for a 1v1.
Just forces a flash on his own right now. Smurf, are you a top laner or what? Act like one. Oddie is just going to straight try and tower dive you here. Oh no, this is a disaster.
Zach, baby, he goes and gets himself the 1v1 against Smurf. We were wondering how effective this pick was going to be. Well, Oddie just shut up all the question marks as he gets himself that outplay onto Smurf.
Zach is back, baby.
So the double TP comes in from both Lissandra and Gnar. Really solid play overall. Lucrit gets the perfect ulti, but Miracle's just in a poor position through and through.
I'm surprised Sayer decided to focus down onto Lucrit. He did use his E early on. He still had his flash. He could have just gone for the flash ultimate onto Miracle to potentially get himself that kill, but decided not to go for it. Also interesting that Kira looked like he actually put a lot of points into his wall, because that was a surprisingly big wall for level 13. Hopefully we'll hover over it so we can have a check later on, but that's not typically the the max path that you'll go for in Anivia. You'll want to try and max the E and the Q as quickly as possible, and then you take the points in the wall for later on to maximize your damage. But regardless, just interesting Anivia facts. What's more important right now is the fact that Albus Nox, who had full control of the early game, have just lost two towers.
Yeah, they get the top tower, they get the bot tower, and they get themselves the dragon. So as the dust settles, a 3,000 gold lead in favor of Lion. Just superior map control, utilizing those double teleports quite well, and Smurf losing the 1v1.
But also, just like, remember that Albus just gave away three kills.
Yeah.
Like, they lost a 2v2 in the bottom. Kira overextending the mid lane with no summoners. Did not respect the Zac whatsoever. And then Smurf just goes and dies 1v1 to Arbitot. Like, these are not plays you can afford to make, especially if you're a team looking to try and make it into Worlds. Dying 1v1 is not an option that you can just go ahead and make, because it's such a big mistake that will cause such a massive deficit.
Yeah, and honestly, PvP Stachos is going to be taking the brunt of that force. A lot of his time is being spent answering to Adi's plays in the bottom side, and if his top lane is dying 1v1 in that scenario, they're getting absolutely nothing. He's losing camps to Jiral, consistently shoving up the top lane and looking to just contest buffs. So if the lanes are converging onto his camps, he's just getting nothing here.
Adi once again just trying to find something here. May have found Steos. We know how much damage he can actually output on the right targets. That percentage of maximum health from unstable matter on the W really starts to take its toll. And unless you're stepping on those Bloblets, it's going to be very difficult. But look at the builds in the bot lane. Lucian already completed his Ghostblade as Miracle still working on the Dustblade.
We've also got the Proto Valve finished for Sayer. So that burst is going to be absolutely monumental from this Lissandra now. Likely going to be working towards the...
White Lotus is caught out here, and this is why they prioritize the Jhin. They love that long-range potential that brings to the team.
So, all right, we were just criticizing Albus for solo dying, and then White Lotus goes and does it. He gets so much praise for his game one performance. He oversteps in the bottom lane, gives away another kill, and this very likely going to be a tower for Albus Nox.
So it was just great for Albus Nox to not only... They sent a Miracle into the long lane. That was a risky fact. But with PvP Stratos there, they were able to set up a play and get the kill on Lucian.
Flash comes out there from Arce, avoids the Tempered Fate and the wall, and we know that Sayer does have the potential to actually lose a 1v1 to Kira, so can't really face check him or meet him in the roam, and we're going to see how this 1v2 unfolded.
Ooh, that was a nice prediction.
He hits all of them, I think.
Yep, all four shots. Very well played from Miracle, to be honest. All right, I don't want to beat on White Lotus too much. That was actually a very good play for Miracle to land the first two shots, because he landed
definitely.
As he dashed as well. So if White Lotus had managed to dash that first one, he may very well have been able to get away, but still shouldn't have been overstepping that much. Depends on your perspective.
Well, that's the thing with these champions with such extreme range, overstepping becomes such an arbitrary term, because what's overstepping against a Jhin who can pretty much hit you from tower to tower?
Well, 25 minutes into the game now, of course they're going to be looking to pressure out this lane. Lion should just look to stall out as much as possible.
Well, he's found his way onto Kira, does have the cleanse and the flash available. Let's Bounce being used, but maybe a little bit preemptively forces the flash to get himself to safety. Off on the side, Culling does a lot of damage onto Lucrit. He may have overstepped once again. This time he definitely overstepped. He's going to get taken down by the barrel. Miracle gets stunned up by the frozen tomb. Jiral in the back. Can he get to Mega? He's getting CC'd up, finds it onto Seos. Can't find the kill. There's the frozen. Brick just gets thrown at him, but Kira, he's finding a few kills here and there. Tempered Fate, not going to land, flashes in, takes him out. Miracle finds another one.
Albus Nox find the fight that they needed. This was something we talked about earlier on before Champion Selector. White Lotus, he is an aggressive player. And in game one, Albus Nox could not punish his aggression. But in game two, they are expecting it. They are prepared for it. And White Lotus, he is experiencing way more gray screen than he initially would have liked. Really good response from Albus to get themselves three kills, but Adi...
Oh, he might be in trouble. Ooh. A perfect wall makes him path straight into the stun, and even without the Rift Herald's help, they're out able to pick him up.
And that's the beauty of a best of five, because they have got him downloaded right now. White Lotus, it started in the bottom lane, where he got... A Miracle got the first bullet on the Lucian, recognized where he was going to duck and dodge, because last game he couldn't get anything. His ulti bullets were just simply not hitting. Now he's recognized where they're going to head, where they're going to dodge. And right now Lion's engages Lion's positioning is getting red.
You can see the issue that you have with a Zac. When you dive in, the only thing you can do is hard commit. And look at how overstepped White Lotus is. He shouldn't have been in this position. He couldn't use his flash because of the engage from Stage Oath. And even with the burst coming out from the Lissandra, it wasn't enough to kill Miracle. The TP from Geralt wasn't an optimal situation. All in all, it just felt like a very broken team fight from Lion. They had different members coming in at different times. Oddie goes in for the hard engage. When he's trying to disengage, White Lotus goes in. The Lissandra then follows up once White Lotus is already taken out of the fight. And honestly, just a messy fight from Lion, but also just really good response from Albus to pick out the correct targets and punish the mistakes of Lion.
Yeah, so this team, Albus Nox right now, they've had great setup, and I feel like they are starting to tighten it up. They are improving as the series goes on.
Look, and I think you're right about Kira maxing that wall second, because at level 15, and it's already taking up pretty much any of the choke points of this game. Definitely has a strategy to that one, but they also have a strategy to pick up five champions that can dash over it.
Right now, another engage.
Yeah, they might be in trouble. Licorice gets taken very, very low. They just love to focus this guy out. Miracle with one shot left in the chamber. Who's it going to be on? Can't find the reload. Does get the snare. Oddie might be in trouble. Doesn't have the passive this time. There's the ulti. Sayer forced to flash away. Geralt in the thick of it. Does he have the bounce available? The wall in the wall. Wallception right now. Doesn't matter because Miracle finds a kill.
So Lion try to force another fight, and unfortunately for them, they are not able to find it. But Albus Nox are feeling incredibly confident. Their positioning in these fights is outstanding. Kira and Miracle sitting at the back line using their zoning tools to just split up Lion Gaming is resulting in them winning fight after fight, and they're going to get themselves an Infernal.
And they just can't fight front to back. It really comes down to positioning because Lissandra is recognized. She's known. She's not going to be able to outright 100-0 the target that they had in Licorice and PvP Stagos. So they just need to be able to set up a fight properly so they can threaten Kira, so they can threaten Miracle. Because at this point in time, there's so much disengage coming from this Albus Nox lineup that if you show up 5v5 in a bush and if you just run at them 100%, that's the fight Albus Nox want.
Kira just going to get himself the blue buff. Does need that mana sustain as Glacial Storm is quite taxing on that mana pool. Licorice seems to just be the focal point. It was him on the brand last game that they were just zeroing out. This time it's the Bard. They followed a few questionable magical journeys to their own demise, so maybe they need to reevaluate their target priority and selection here.
It's really difficult for Lion to again find these fights because when you think about the amount of zone control, hang on a second, Stage shows.
You should be fine. Just walks up to the wall, feigns the E, and they just back off. Doesn't even have to use it.
Didn't even notice them. It was almost like he was in a drunk coma.
He's just in a trance state.
Did someone hit me? I'm just going to stare at this wall for a while I calm down. But you can see now Lion on the back foot. The question is now for Albus Nox, how do they break into these tier 2 turrets? Because the gangplank is at 3 items, it's very powerful, and they might just brute force it, but they have to be careful of the potential flank and re-engage power that Lion has.
They do have the vision. Oddie gets knocked out of the jump. Can't seem to find it, but Stayhose now might be in a little bit of trouble. Two stacks on the concussive blow. Sayer trying to find his way over the Gromp wall, but sticking as a 5-man unit.
That was beautiful.
Yeah.
That was beautiful.
It was, and this is the difficulty of Zac, especially in this matchup. People don't actually like picking Zac into a few champions, one of them being Thresh, another one being Gragas, because it's very easy to understand where Zac is falling down, because there's a shadow that gets placed and he's going straight in.
Yeah, Oddie, he does hit the 5-man, let's bounce, and it's an absolute party right now, but it could be a party that the side of Lion weren't invited to. Arce, he is quite low, Oddie goes down, here comes Sayer over the wall, gets completely denied by the body slam. A huge Gnar comes in from Geralt, but that might spell his end. The damage coming out, stuns being laid on by Licorice, and Anox looking unstoppable.
I'm telling you, PvP Stayos is playing godly this game. He has denied so many of the engage coming out of this team.
He certainly has such an impressive performance. And Albus Nox, they're looking to try and equalize this series as they break into the base of Lion.
Look, they're firing on all cylinders right now. Two towers going for that inhibitor as well off the back of three kills. And Arce and White Lotus forced to watch as their base is left in tatters.
So I was critical of the Anivia during Champion Select. I felt like that the hard engage of Lion would just be too much for this Anivia and this Jhin to deal with. But my god, Stagios, you are certainly proving me wrong. Every single time Lion tried to hard engage, he is always there saying no. You shall not pass, ladies and gentlemen. You will get nowhere near. And just watch this, right? So here we have Oddy coming in. Stage just tries to interrupt, but he can't. The wall splits up the hard engage from Anox. That gives time for Kira to disengage. Once Lion have overcommitted, that's when the Gangplank ultimate comes in. Now here, Seiya, watch this. Great knockup from Stagios, instantly pops that, and you can just see the disjointedness from Lion. They want to get the hard 4-5 versus 5 all-in comp, but Albus Nox are just dividing up the team and forcing them to just come in one at a time, breaking up this hard wombo combo that they have available to themselves, and it's just resulting in Albus Nox consistently coming ahead in these fights.
And right now the Gangplank is doing so much work. It really comes down to the fact that you're starting to understand why it's been getting banned throughout the entire series. They're unable to really threaten him in the individual matchup. He's coming out of the Gnar matchup well and truly alive. And then every single time they try and hard engage onto this Albus Nox backline, every time the disengage comes out with PvP Stagios, the moment that happens, the re-engage with Gragas or Gangplank ulti comes down, and it does a billion damage.
Tempered Fate lands onto two, should have no trouble hitting the Q off that, but they didn't bank on the Anivia one also. Not going to follow it up with too much. But this just comes back to Anox playing League of Legends that they love. The Bard, the Jhin, the Anivia. It's all resonates with how these guys love to play League, and Seiya, he may have been caught out here. He's just going to get exploded.
No idea why Seiya's even there. He has his flash. There's no need to be past your turret. You should be helping with the wave clear. Now zoning ult.
Body comes in with a nice full range classic slingshot, but that's a double kill for Miracle already. Looking for some more. Oddy does get stunned up. A little minion being his downfall here. Jiral forced a Mega Gnar to safety, and that's another tower that bites the dust.
This has been Albus Nox's game. It's showing through their team fights. It's showing through their control, their confidence right now. They have understood Lion's playstyle. They've understood their confidence and how willing they are to go in, and they were just able to just time and time again counter it and take the game from
them. And I think they can end the game right now.
Oddy again! They're definitely trying for it. Stagios once again denies Oddy from getting in the backline. There's Zac not doing enough. The first Nexus turret goes down. The second one soon to follow. How long are the death timers? They're way too long right now. Jiral can't even get into Mega. He goes down, and just like that, Anox answer, and they answer strong.
Albus Nox with the return game, equalizing the score 1-1 now. Definitely not what I was expecting, if I'm honest. I felt like the Lion, they had Albus's number. They had a strong draft coming into game two. But I mean, we just have to backtrack to the very early game. We have to remember 6-2 was the kill score in favor of Albus Nox early on. They got themselves a lot of early kills, and a large part of that was thanks to this gank in the bottom lane. There was just advantages being accrued in the bottom lane, in the mid lane, and Stagios was just having a fantastic game. His pressure was so much better because he just wasn't sitting in the top half of the map. Smurf was undergoing a lot of pressure himself, but because of how well he was playing, he was able to turn a lot of bad situations around, and he was still relevant thanks to the kills that he was able to pick up. In all honesty, it just got to a point where Lion just didn't build up a big enough lead in the early to mid game, where once you started hitting these mid to late game fights, Albus were just too far ahead for them to be able to turn it around.
Exactly. I like the idea of the composition for Albus Nox. If they were able to pick up their early game, allow their mid and top laner to not fall too far behind. And it was off the back of Likrit and PvP Stagios, their roams, really spot on. Likrit once again able to show that his push, his movement around the map is always spot on.
And the instant White Lotus steps on that captive audience, that's the go button. They turn on, they catch out the carry, and Anox, they look like they were playing all on the same page here, where Lion a little bit disjointed at times.
I was honestly just very impressed with the Nivea overall. Kira demonstrating why he was well known for the champion. He had some fantastic walls, maxing it second. A little bit unorthodox, not what we usually see, but he was making it work. This is just another example of where you could see Lion trying to force a fight. The amount of zone control that Anox had made it so difficult for the rest of Lion to actually efficiently follow up. And look at Miracle at the backline, completely safe. Yeah. Never takes any damage. He's never at risk of ever being collapsed upon. And it was just overall really good positioning and fantastic team fighting coming out from the side of Albus Nox.
Yeah, exactly. So they're able to take the game. They're able to take it in the same style, honestly, that they were able to draw the last game back. Game 1 went to 55 minutes simply because of the zone control and absolute damage coming out of the Gangplank pick, and at the same time, the Jhin pick as well. And so Gangplank, Jhin, and Gragas coming through time and time again, honestly stopping the initial force and pressure coming from Lion Gaming. Which pick goes away? Which pick do they leave up? Game 3 leaves a lot of questions.
Well, that's the thing, right? These guys have shown proficiency on so many unorthodox champions. The Brand, the Bard, the Anivia as well. Like, I agree that the Zac pick was kind of questionable and they should have been able to execute early on in the game. We saw when the combo comes down, just jump straight onto Anivia. She has no way to escape. Frozen Tomb comes down. She's kaput. There's nothing she can do about that. But there were like 3 times where she just walked out of the Elastic Slingshot.
Yeah. And I mean, I feel like there should have been more pressure in the mid lane. That you could have set up a lot more ganks in the early game. Lissandra is a very easy lane to gank for. The risk was the cleanse. She also had the egg. It can be a little bit difficult, but it was also the fact that Oddi was just prioritizing the top half of the map. And I just bring into question, sure, Zac might be an interesting pick, something that you like, but why is it better than a Rek'Sai? Why is it better than a Gragas? Why was it better than the Nidalee or the Elise? That all these top 4 jungle champions are top tier for a reason, and they could have very easily fit into this composition, but instead they went for something a little bit unorthodox, and I do feel like in part it punished them, but at the same time, you cannot take anything away from Stagios, who honestly just played out of his mind this game.
Alrighty, guys, another exciting game. We're tied up 1-1, but we're going to go to a short break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.